Episode 18. Title of the course is Advanced Material Science, Unit 5. In this episode, we will discuss about Langevin theory of paramagnetism. Langevin considered a paramagnetic gas in which each atom or molecule possesses a permanent magnetic moment. This magnetic moment are arising from a particular combination of orbital and spin magnetic moments of the electron. This magnetic moment, in the absence of any external field, point in random direction, so that there is no resultant magnetic moment for paramagnetic material. Even though each atom or molecule possesses intrinsic permanent magnetic moment, this happens because the interaction energy between the dipoles is smaller than the thermal energy given by KT, where K is Boltzmann constant and T is temperature of the material in Kelvin. When an external field is applied, the individual atomic magnetic moment turn to line up along the field direction, and individual atomic moment produces a net magnetization counteracting the thermal agitation. When the atoms and ions are acted upon individually with no mutual interaction between them, the effect is called paramagnetism. Paramagnetism depends upon the magnetic moment of ions or atom. So the state of magnetization will be determined by the applied magnetic field and thermal agitation. The probability that a dipole incline at an angle to the field direction in thermal equilibrium is proportional to exponential of mu capital B cos theta divided by KT by Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution law. If N0 is the total number of dipoles, then the number of dipoles N inclined at an angle theta with the field direction is given by N is equal to N0 of exponential of mu B cos theta divided by KT. Average magnetic moment mu bar in the field direction is given by the sum of the resolved components of magnetic moments of all the dipoles in the field direction divided by the total number of dipoles. Therefore, mu bar is equal to integration of mu cos theta dn divided by integration of dn, where dn is equal to minus N0 exponential of mu b cos theta divided by kt into sin theta d theta into mu b divided by kt. Therefore, mu bar is equal to minus N0 integration of mu cos theta exponential of mu b cos theta divided by kt into sin theta d theta divided by minus N0 integral of exponential of mu b cos theta divided by kt into sin theta d theta. Putting the limits for theta and keeping alpha equal to mu b divided by kt. Therefore, mu bar is equal to integration of 0 to pi mu cos theta exponential of alpha cos theta into sin theta d theta divided by integration of 0 to pi exponential of alpha cos theta sin theta d theta. Put cos theta is equal to x. Therefore, minus sin theta d theta is equal to dx. Therefore, mu bar is become integration of minus 1 to 1 mu x exponential of alpha x dx divided by integration of minus 1 to 1 exponential of alpha x dx. Now, integration of minus 1 to 1 x exponential alpha x dx is equal to integration minus 1 to 1 x d into exponential of alpha x divided by alpha into dx. This is equal to x exponential of alpha x divided by alpha over minus 1 to 1 minus integration of minus 1 to 1 exponential of alpha x divided by alpha. Here we can integrate this equation by integration u dv method, that is equal to uv minus integration of v du. Therefore we can get the equation x exponential of alpha x divided by alpha minus exponential of alpha x divided by a square over minus 1 to 1. This equation is equal to e power alpha divided by alpha minus e power alpha divided by alpha square overall minus minus e power minus alpha divided by alpha minus e power minus alpha divided by alpha square. This equation is very similar to 1 by alpha into e power alpha plus e power minus alpha minus 1 by alpha square into e power alpha minus e power minus alpha. Similarly, integration of minus 1 to 1 of exponential of ax dx is equal to e power alpha x divided by alpha over minus 1 to 1 is equal to 1 by alpha into e power alpha minus e power minus alpha. Putting the values of the integral in the above equation for mu bar, we get mu bar is equal to mu into alpha divided by e power alpha minus e power minus alpha into 1 by alpha into e power alpha plus e power minus alpha minus e power alpha minus e power minus alpha divided by alpha square. Therefore we can get mu bar is equal to mu into e power alpha plus e power minus alpha divided by e power alpha minus e power minus alpha minus 1 by alpha is equal to mu into cot alpha minus 1 by alpha. Therefore mu bar is equal to mu into L of alpha, where L of alpha is called Langevin function. Consider mu b is very greater than kt or alpha is very large. In such case t is very small, b is large, then mu bar is become mu bar is equal to mu. If capital N is the number of dipoles per unit volume, the magnetization I is equal to N mu bar, that is also equal to N mu equal to Is, where Is is the saturation value of magnetization. So the intensity of the magnetization capital I is equal to capital N mu bar is equal to N mu bar B divided by 3 kT, that is also equal to N mu square mu naught H divided by 3 kT. Therefore susceptibility chi is equal to I divided by capital H, that is also equal to mu N mu square divided by 3 kT. This equation is very similar to C by T, where C is called Curie constant and relation is called Curie law or Curie-Langevin relation, since Curie found experimentally this relation before Langevin theoretical derivation. Remarks of this theory: we get the saturation value of magnetization when T is small and B is large. At absolute zero, when there is no thermal agitation, all the molecular magnet will be quite free to turn along the direction of the field, and the smallest field should produce complete saturation in the case of paramagnetic gas. This however will not be the case of two reasons. Firstly, the paramagnetic gas will solidify at the temperature, and the mutual interaction will have to be taken in account, and secondly, the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution law will not be hold good. The above discussion is satisfied expert for very low temperature. It is failed to explain the complicated type of dependence of susceptibility upon temperature exhibited by several paramagnetic example compressed and cooled gases, solids, salts and crystals, etc. Further, it is not given any relationship between para and ferromagnetism. Then we move on to Weiss theory of paramagnetism. To remove the failures of Langevin theory, Weiss assumed that in a real gas, molecules are mutually influenced by their magnetic momentum, and consequently there should exist within the gas molecule field. This field produced at any point by all neighboring molecule is proportional to the intensity of magnetization. Let this internal molecular field be represented by Hi, then Hi is equal to lambda I, where lambda is the molecular field coefficient or Weiss constant. Therefore, the net effective field should be He is equal to H plus Hi, which is a vector sum of external applied field capital H and internal molecular field Hi, following the Langevin theory along the effective field. Therefore, I is equal to mu naught mu square n He divided by 3kT, that is equal to mu naught mu square into n. We can substitute He value in this place, H plus lambda I divided by 3kT. Rearranging this equation, we can get I into 1 minus mu naught mu square n lambda divided by 3kT is equal to mu naught mu square nh divided by 3kT. Put C is equal to mu naught mu square n divided by 3k, and theta is equal to C lambda. We can get the equation I into 1 minus theta divided by T is equal to CH divided by T. Therefore, chi is equal to I divided by H, that is also equal to C divided by T into 1 minus theta divided by T. This equation, finally, chi is equal to C divided by T minus theta, where C is called Curie constant and theta is called paramagnetic Curie point or Curie temperature. The equation is called Curie-Weiss law. From the we can infer the below Curie temperature, that means T is less than theta, susceptibility becomes negative. That means paramagnetics would become diamagnetics. However, Curie temperature is quite low for most of the paramagnetic substances, and also situated for which T is less than theta is rare. Then we move on to Weiss theory or molecular field theory of ferromagnetism. The transition metal Fe, CO and Ni exhibit magnetization even the magnetizing field is removed. This phenomena is called ferromagnetism. Weiss postulate the existence of an internal molecular field Hi, which favors spontaneous magnetization of a ferromagnetic material and is proportional to magnetization I of the material. This magnetization I is called spontaneous magnetization. That means the spontaneous magnetization is arised in the absence of any applied field. Hi is equal to lambda I, we know already, where lambda is molecular field coefficient or Weiss constant. The net effective magnetic field is then equal to H plus Hi. Therefore, He is equal to H plus Hi. Therefore, this equation becomes H plus lambda I. Therefore, I is equal to mu naught mu square NHe/3kT. We already discussed about this equation. This is equal to mu naught mu square N/3kT into H plus lambda I. Rearranging the term, we can get I into 1 minus mu naught mu square N/3kT is equal to mu naught mu square N/3kT into capital H. Put C is equal to mu naught mu square capital N/3k and theta is equal to C lambda. We can get I into 1 minus theta divided by T is equal to CH divided by T. Therefore, chi is equal to I by H. Therefore, C divided by T into 1 minus theta divided by T is also equal to C divided by T minus theta. This is called Curie-Weiss law and theta is called Curie temperature. When T is equal to theta, chi is infinity means, and for the temperature less than theta, the relation does not signify any meaning. This means there exists a spontaneous magnetization even the absence of external magnetic field. The material is ferromagnetic below Curie temperature, that means theta, and becomes paramagnetic above the Curie temperature. Thermal agitation opposes the tendency of Weiss molecule field to align the molecular magnets, but below Curie temperature, Weiss field energy overcome the thermal energy. Consequently, alignment of most molecular magnets resulting giving rise to magnetization of the material even the absence of applied field. So-called phenomenon of spontaneous magnetization, that means but at room temperature, an ordinary piece of iron is not magnetic in the absence of an applied field. Weiss conceived the idea of magnetic domain. We will see the next section. Temperature dependence of spontaneous magnetization, referring the experimental curve. When T is 0, I by IS is 1, that is the spontaneous magnetization is maximum. Here I is spontaneous magnetization and IS is saturation magnetization. When T is equal to theta, I/IS becomes 0 and the spontaneous magnetization vanishes. When the temperature is low, Weiss field overcomes the thermal energy and at T is 0. Gives rise to maximum magnetization, but as the temperature increases, thermal energy increases, which more and more of the parallel spin, and at Curie temperature the parallel alignment of the spin vanishes, resulting in the zero value of spontaneous magnetization. The substance then becomes paramagnetic. Then we'll move on to magnitude of Weiss field, that is denoted as Bi. Let us take the Curie temperature for iron as 1000 Kelvin, and at Curie temperature the dipole energy mu Bi is equal to K theta. Substituting the value of K and theta in this expression, we can find the dipole energy. From the one can find the value internal molecular magnetic induction is of the order of 10^3 Weber per meter square, but obviously dipole interaction gives rise to a field induction of the order of 10^-1 Weber per meter square, and so such an enormous internal molecular field cannot be explained by magnetic dipole interaction. This is also one of the failures of Weiss field of ferromagnetism. Then we move on to Heisenberg's theory of ferromagnetism. Following the quantum theory, Heisenberg pointed out the magnetization of ferromagnetic materials arises due to electron spin rather than due to orbital motion. High value of internal field can be explained in terms of exchange interaction between the electrons. An exchange force is caused by static Coulomb interaction and its magnitude can be much larger than that of magnetic interaction. This exchange force appears in the form of spin-spin interaction. The strength of interaction depends upon the intra-atomic separation, and it may change its sign as the separation is varied. Assume in each atom unpaired electrons are in parallel orientation. If the intra-atomic separation decreases the electron spin of unpaired electrons, if it decreases more and more, exchange forces decreases until finally they pass through zero and anti-parallel spin alignment is favored. If R absorbed is equal to intra-atomic separation and R0 is the orbital radius of unpaired electrons, then a magnetic state is favored when R absorbed divided by R0 is slightly larger than 3. For Fe and Co and Ni, this ratio has value 3.26, 3.64, 3.94 respectively. Thus, Heisenberg explained the enormous value of the intermolecular field and gave the theory of ferro, antiferro and ferrimagnetic material. On this basis, exchange interaction between spins. Let us consider two ferromagnetic atoms A and B in the lattice. Let their wave function chi base A and chi base B and the unpaired electron B 1 and 2 having negative charges. The interaction potential VAB between the ion of A and B electron 1 and 2 can be written as VAB is equal to E square divided by 4 pi epsilon naught into 1 by RA plus 1 by R12 minus 1 by RB1 minus 1 by RB2 minus 1 by RA1 minus 1 by RA2, where RA distance between atom A and B, where R12 is distance between electron 1 and 2, RB1 is distance between atom B and electron 1, RB2 distance between atom B and electron 2, RA1 is distance between atom A and electron 1, RA2 is the distance between atom A and electron 2. The charge of each ion, that means atom, is equal to E. The total exchange interaction energy between spin of unpaired electron of the system is given by XEX is equal to minus summation ij of jij of E S1 vector dot Sj vector, where S1 I is equal to Sj is equal to half spin magnetic moment. For parallel spin, theta is equal to 0. And for anti-parallel spin, theta is become pi. Here, exchange integral Je is equal to integration of chi star A of 1, chi star B of 2, VAB chi A of 1, chi B of 2, dr1, dr2, which is proportional to the probability that the electron 1 in an atom A will be exchanged with electron 2 in the atom B. It is found the value of Je for Mn and gamma Fe are negative. Both thus, the substance antiferromagnetic and for this R observed divided by R0 is less than 3. There is an anti-parallel alignment of spin in the adjacent spin. Similar, if 3 is less than, that means RA absorbed by R naught is greater than or less than 5.0, then JE value are positive and there is parallel alignment of spin. Thus, ferromagnetism exists in alpha Fe, CO and Ni. It shows that the property of ferromagnetism are purely depending on the nearest neighboring distance. Domain theory of ferromagnetism. Weiss proposed the concept of domains in 1907 to explain the stress effect observed in ferromagnetic materials as well as to explain the properties of ferromagnetic material. The region in a ferromagnetic or ferrimagnetic material where all magnetic moments are aligned in the same direction is called a domain. So a ferromagnetic material is divided up into the small regions called domains, each of which is at all times completely magnetized. The direction of magnetization, however, varies from domain to domain, and thus the net macroscopic magnetization is zero. In a virgin specimen, the absence of external magnetic field, but when the ferromagnetic material is in the magnetic field in the initial stage of magnetization in the material, the domains having moment parallel to magnetic field increases in the area. In the final saturation stage, the other domain are rotated parallel to the field. Similarly, we demagnetize the material, the regular domain arrangement is changed and it is different from the original state. This creates the stress in the ferromagnetic substance. If a magnetic is broken into pieces, each piece will be magnet with a north and a south pole. This is becomes the domains continue to remain in broken piece. A magnetic heated or roughly handled turns to lose its magnetism. This is because the alignment of domains in the magnetic is likely to distribute during heating and rough handling. Hence, magnetism is reduced or lost. Domains of soft ion are easily rotated with a comparatively small magnetizing force and hence they are very easily to magnetize or demagnetize. In the case of steel, large force is required for rotating the domains, which explains high of that material retentivity. The specimen when magnetized suddenly experiences a slight change in its length, which is due to rearranging of domain insides. This is called magnetostriction effect. This is used to generate the ultrasonic waves for most of the applications. There are two possible ways to align a random domain structure by applying an external magnetic field. By motion of domain walls, that means by an increasing in the volume of domains that are favorably oriented with respect to magnetizing field, the cost of those that unfavorably oriented shows that the arrangement of domains for zero resultant magnetic moment in a single crystal or virgin specimen when there is no applied magnetic field. By rotation of domains, that means by the rotation of the direction, magnetization of the domain along the direction of the field. In weak magnetizing field, the magnetization of the specimen is due to the motion of domain walls, and in strong field, that is due to the rotation of domains. To study the domain structure clearly, we must know the four types of energy involved in the process of domain growth. That is, first one is exchange energy, second one is crystal anisotropic energy, third one is magnetostatic energy, fourth one is magnetostrictivity energy. These are the important things to study the domain structure clearly. We must know the four types of energy involved in the process of domain growth. Dear student, we will discuss these four types of energy involved in the process of domain growth in next episode. Thank you.